Bus. Visit our website at booktv.org/booktvbus.
Book TV wraps up live coverage of the 2009 Chicago Tribune Printers Row Lit Fest with Harvey Pekar, author of the comic book series American Splendor, and Paul Buhle, historian of the American Left. They discuss their new book, Studs Terkel's Working, a graphic adaptation.
Okie dokie.
Okay, we're done. We gotta go.
Okay, we gotta go.
Welcome to the 25th annual Chicago Tribune Printers Row Lit Fest. We would like to give a special thanks to our sponsors and community partners who help make this event possible. Just a few housekeeping notes before we begin today's program. Please turn off your cell phone and all other electronic devices. Flash photography is also not permitted. Today's program will be broadcast live on C-SPAN 2's Book TV. If there's time at the end for a question and answer session, we ask you to use the microphone located at the center of the room so that the home viewing audience can hear your question. If you would like to watch this program again, note that our coverage will be re-aired Saturday evening beginning at 10 p.m. Central Standard Time. Please welcome our moderators, Elizabeth Taylor and Rick Kogan of the Chicago Tribune.
I got to tell you something. This book is more than capable of speaking on its own, and I think the only reason Liz and I are here is because we are having Studs withdrawal. For the last 8 years, Liz and I shared that stage at the Harold Washington Library with Studs, talking about his life, his times. Liz has known him for a long time. I have known him since the day he came to Wesley Hospital, the night I was born, to take my dad out for a drink. That's a very long time, and it's hard to shake Studs, who died on Halloween this year. But this book brings him back to life for me in an unexpected and unbelievably charming and real way. I know you agree, Liz. Paul and Harvey, whose idea, how'd you do this? Who's the genius who came up with this? It's unbelievably good. Did he?
Okay, yeah, I mean, it was, Paul deserves, I think, you know, Paul deserves, you know, like, I think a lion's share of the material, I mean, the praise for doing the book. For one thing, he's taught oral history for a long time at Brown University, and, you know, he's for a long time been a Studs Terkel admirer and fan. I think that, you know, that I think the artwork was real nice too, and you know, it was just
it's not all yours either. It's not all yours, is it?
No. I mean, you know, I didn't mess around with his words. I didn't change anything.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, I just broke the text down into panels for, you know, for some of the artists that apparently didn't want to, or I don't know what. But anyway, that's...
Yeah.
But Paul, I've been working with Paul on a few projects now. And he suggests some, and then...
When he suggested this, did you all of a sudden go, were you excited immediately about it?
I'm always excited when I get a chance to make more money. Nothing thrills me more. But I mean, you know, I you know, I was aware of Studs Terkel, and I have a, you know, a connection with him. We both are real interested in quotidian life and stuff. Yeah, I guess he interviewed,
mostly because you let it, you know.
Well, he interviewed people about their jobs, and I just, you know, used to just write, and I wrote about my job. You know, it's like an autobiographical thing. But, you know, I mean, I immediately saw, you know, like felt an affinity for him when I became aware of him, I guess, in the 70s.
Did you ever meet him?
No, I never have.
That's a shame. I mean, I can speak for, you guys would have loved each other. I'm serious. Don't you think, those of you? So, Paul, the seed of this is, had you talked about this with Studs?
Just a little, a very small amount, and mainly through friends in the year or two. So, I had done a book or two with the New Press, really wonderful publisher, And they are responsible for bringing out Studd's work in so many volumes. And it seemed like a natural step for me to propose a Studd's Comics volume because the New Press embodies his work, but also because, as Harvey suggested, from my point of view, I taught oral history for a decade at Brown, and when you teach oral history to college students, or for that matter, high school students, or Studd's is the one and only charismatic personality in the field of oral history. There are some people who write extremely intelligently about the philosophy of it and the problems with it and so on and so forth, and there are thousands of us, me included, who've done a whole lot of field work of our own in oral history. But when you think of books to assign that give students at any level an idea of what oral history can do, you invariably come back to Studd's as the first person. And that's true for oral historians, people who teach oral history in Europe and presumably Asia, everywhere in the world, as well as the United States. There's no figure like Studd's Terkel within oral history, a small field, a field that has very little respect within academic life, but which represents a popular approach to history that is par excellence, that exceeds any other historian's grip of the quotidian life.
Well, I think, as Liz well knows, and talk about this, Liz, that one of the great things about Studd's is a trained actor. Before he started doing oral histories, and he fell into different radio shows and was really good at that. And he was the most mechanically inept human being in the world. I mean, talking about most oral historians would go in and say, please, let's talk, and just sit there. Studd's would.
Well, he would always say that, one of his great advantages was that he was inept with the tape recorder, right? And,
yeah.
And then one of his amazing stories, I love this story. It tells of a woman in public housing. Is this one you were talking about, Rick? It's amazing, the story in public housing, and he's interviewed her, and her small child is, after the interview, before the interview, there's futzing with the tape recorder, and then they have the interview, and then the boy goes back to the tape recorder, and as Studd's tells it much better than I, watches the kid, and then suddenly the tape plays, and it's the woman's voice. Mm. And she says, I never knew I felt that way. Mm. And I feel like that's what Studd's is about. He just...
That was the genius of it. Wouldn't you think, Paul, that he was able to, and in reading it in this fashion, which I think, and tell me I'm wrong about this, I don't know much about, I'm old-fashioned that way, but I know graphic novels and graphic representations of words are becoming increasingly popular, that this is a way, I think, to introduce Studd's to that generation that might ordinarily or might miss him.
Sure. Absolutely. It's also true of the book we'll be talking about tomorrow, The Beats, because it's a way of getting readers, mainly under 25, to look at books, think about reading those books when they simply wouldn't come into contact with them otherwise.
A question. Studd's has written so many wonderful books, The Good War, which he always said, Ida said it should be in parentheses, mm-hmm. Good War, Hard Times, Division Street. Mm-hmm. So how did you decide?
Well, that's a great question. I'm anticipating that question because I went round and round with the New Press editors about it. And I had different suggestions at different times. Hard Times has always been a fabulously important book to me, and I don't want to put aside his stuff with jazz musicians and everything else that most of this audience could come up with. And the answer probably is pretty simple, that Working is the book that is perhaps even better known than Studd's himself at this point. Mm-hmm. It just happened that the state endowments for the humanities produced little playlets based on Working 20 years ago. And it just happened that I was the humanist in the little state of Rhode Island who would then engage the audience in a conversation about it. It's all sort of like an occurrence. What Working managed to do, in my experience with audiences and with students, was to epitomize what's best in oral history which is to say to legitimate the daily lives of ordinary people who would not consider themselves worthy or at least likely ever to be interviewed and ever talk about their own lives in that fashion, which is exactly what the point Liz brought up. I mean, it's not an unusual thing in any field of oral history with ordinary blue-collar or low middle-class people to say after the interview, I never knew I felt that way, or indeed to begin crying. That's a perfectly ordinary experience of somebody interviewing somebody in their 60s, 70s, and 80s. It just things come up that they didn't anticipate speaking about. And as I always say to students, you don't want to stop them from crying or anything, because this is an experience that's terribly important to them. It validates their life in some fashion or another. But even though that is the oral history experience, in a way, nobody so well articulated it and demonstrated it over the last 30 years as Studs did, and one could say he created the field of oral history.
So you decide to do this book. Do you immediately think of Harvey?
Yes, a little bit, because I had already begun working with Harvey. We did a book on the Students for a Democratic Society together. And because suddenly it hit me, maybe in the middle of the night, as these things do, the awakening moment at 2 a.m., that Harvey, in many ways, was a Studs Terkel of a different generation, and by virtue of spending 36 years in the VA hospital as a file clerk in Cleveland, had grasped one of the key points that comes up in working, at least it's key to me, and that is that blue-collar and white-collar life in the before the 1970s, before the 1980s perhaps, was very frequently like my father's life as a civil servant. It was really boring, but you never took your work home with you at night. And people would say that was a good job. Hmm. Now, I don't say the world is a better or worse place in that respect now, but it's a very, very different place.
Yeah, I was a civil servant, and, you know, I was happy to get the job. Another thing I wanted to say about Studs being mechanically inept, and that's one reason that I like him so much, because I never learned how to ride a bike. I can't type, let alone use a computer, any of that stuff. It's just like, I don't see how people can do that.
Do you drive?
God, Studs love this guy.
Doesn't drive.
God, love you.
I mean, you know, so I mean, when I read that, it's a warm feeling.
There's a lot of editing. Sorry, there's a lot of editing that to select which ones you might want. I'm thinking that Paul, you initially culled these down, or was it a collaborative thing with Harvey?
It's a wonderful question. There's some artists who wanted to script their own work and said so from the very beginning. A great example is Sabrina Jones, a fabulous artist who intuitively went to the story of the prostitute and dealt with it in a way that seems utterly remarkable to me and brings it to life. There are other artists who got this into their minds at one certain thing they wanted and couldn't do anything else. Another wonderful example would be Peter Cooper, who's done the Spy versus Spy pages of Mad Magazine for 20 years. But he's a very radical guy, and quite naturally he wanted to do the labor organizer. In many other cases, though, when it was Harvey who decided that these are particular stories that came to life in a remarkable sort of way, and the artists were very excited about working with Harvey. Many comic artists in the U.S. and elsewhere really want to work with Harvey. And so together, but Harvey more than me, we selected the ones that were quote-unquote workable. And it was as pragmatic as that, and unpolitical or unideological or whatever that, because I'm perfectly convinced that another selection could have been made from working that was none of these people and was all different people, and it also would have been fabulous.
Yeah, I think everything in the, in working could have been just done, you know, somebody could have done an excellent job on it. They're all fine pieces.
It strikes me, reading this, that many of the jobs here don't exist anymore. Right. Brett Hauser, supermarket box boy, that job is gone. others.
Not in Cleveland.
You have much better supermarkets than we do in Chicago. Others, I mean, there's a certain, you know, touching quality to that, and sad.
Well, did you see the guy who was predicting the end of, like, shoe manufacturing
in the U.S.,
in the United
anyway.
States?
Yeah. A well-known Chicago unionist.
Yeah.
I think it's still true, and certainly people at Worth Computers believe it to be true, that people value a lot what they do with their work, the skill that they put into their work. I was thinking about this barber when I had my hair cut the other day by an 80-year-old guy in Madison, Wisconsin. And has he for almost 60 years thought he was really good at cutting hair and been proud of cutting hair? Absolutely. Has that question been posed to him in that way by anybody other than saying, gee, that's nice? Probably never. And I think that's another fabulous thing that Studs did, was to value that kind of, I wouldn't call it thankless, but value that kind of unacknowledged skill at jobs of all levels, many of which, as you point out, have now disappeared. And in that way, for readers of Studs' book, allow them to value their own jobs, whether they were the same jobs or similar jobs. I mean, one of the most problematic ones, in a way, for an artist, by artist named Nick Torkelson, quite a wonderful artist, was about the garbage man. Mm-hmm. Because the garbage man, in effect, works a job which is devalued from the very beginning, mm-hmm, by everybody. The children are ashamed of him doing it. But on the other hand, he knows it has to be done. It's a social service, and he personally isn't ashamed. So it was fabulous for Studs to do it. It was a problem that was solved for an artist to translate that into pictures.
I just want to read something for those of you who may not, for those of you who have working on a shelf. I go back to working all the time to read a specific thing. The salesman one just gets me. I reread it like every 5 months. In the introduction, the original introduction, I'm not going to read much. But he says, this book, being about work, is, by its very nature, about violence to the spirit as well as to the body. And jumping ahead a couple graphs, think about this. It is about a search, too, for daily meaning as well as daily bread, for recognition as well as cash, for astonishment rather than torpor. In short, for a sort of life rather than a Monday through Friday sort of dying. Perhaps immortality, too, is part of the quest. To be remembered was the wish, spoken and unspoken, of the heroes and heroines in this book. That's a pretty amazing sort of take on life. And that doesn't matter. I don't care if you work for Microsoft or you're still a garbage man. That resonates with me and will ever resonate with me. Harvey, you must, and that's just an amazing observation about what all of us do. I don't care how good your job is. I don't care how cool your job is.
Everybody contributes something.
Yeah.
And some people get credit and some people don't.
Uh-huh.
Probably mainly because of the income disparities and stuff. Hey, I wanted to tell you a story I read. There was a Chicago sports writer, I forget his name, but his stuff used to be printed in Cleveland papers too. And He said he just got mugged this one time, and it was a pretty unpleasant experience. He said, now, if it would have been Studs Terkel and the guy had tried to mug him, he would have probably just whipped out his, you know, tape recorder and tried to interview him.
Well, tell them about Studs getting, Studs got burgled after Ida had died.
That's right.
Studs was burgled,
right.
And
you tell.
We invite the burglar in. He's, right. What are you doing?
Right.
You know, I've only got eight. I've got $8.
Right.
That's all I've got. Right. Why do you want to rob anybody? And then they put this, like, the word, a sign on the door after this happened that would have scared nobody. It's like, you know, dog inside or something.
Right. You know, and there's a dog bowl. That's
a fake dog bowl outside.
Right. It's like never any water, and there's, you know, practically grass growing out of it. And so you never know. But remember, he always used to say, "I've been a victim of a hostile takeover."
That's quite wonderful.
Well, I think you sense in this book, and just seeing it brought to life in this kind of graphic way just tells me, and I know you know this, Paul, Liz, and I think you too, Harvey, that he was as engaged with life, meaning life and other people, as any human being I've ever met, into his 90s, until, you know, hours before he died. I want to know from all three of you, what kind of a human miracle is that? I mean, Studs has ever been an inspiration to me, and I think to Liz, too, because we knew him. And I try to live. I feel guilty if I'm, like, lying watching a TV show and not listening to Miles Davis or reading a new book or something. You know, it's a force of nature. It's, Liz?
He just had this capacity. In fact, and it's just completely informed me. We were at this sort of fancy dinner last night, raising money for the schools. The Harold Washington Award sort of kicks off the book fair. And Dave Eggers is the winner of the award. And we're sitting at this dinner, and Dave Eggers, you know, who's just done so much with his reading and tutoring centers throughout the nation, and has done so much for publishing for writers and kids. And I said, how did you get that way? And I heard myself, I remembered so vividly that I had been sitting at Studs' house with Edgar, E.L. Doctorow, and Studs, Doctorow was talking about his own life, and Studs said, how did you get that way?
Right.
And Doctorow said, nobody's really asked me that. And I realized that you know, Studs has given me this gift to kind of internalize his worldview.
And so Dave amazing. Eggers thinks you're the smartest human being he's ever met.
No, he thinks that none of my table mates thought she's, this woman is off a rocker.
What do you think, Paul, about
well,
that?
You know, intellectuals, book writers, and so forth, of which this conference is rightly famous, book festival is rightly famous, have one big vice, in my opinion, and that is we tend to look past people.
Mm-hmm.
We're thinking about ideas. I think this is more a male vice than a female vice in general, but we tend to look past people because we are trying to get some kind of abstraction about them or fit the abstraction into them and vice versa. Whereas, in my view, and again, going back to my years and years of teaching but also doing oral histories, the real trick is to look straight into people and see them for what they are and take them for what they are and draw them out. I mean, it's a really just a perfectly obvious sort of thing. And yet, to be able to manage that level of concentration effortlessly, seemingly effortlessly, throughout an extremely long lifetime, in Studs' case, requires a very deep egalitarian or socialistic mentality that never slips into the usual didacticism and laying it on heavy to people and uplifting them and all the other things that intellectuals are mistakenly doing. But to that, I want to add that since I started reading American Splendor comics in the middle 1970s, which were largely about Harvey being on street corners in Cleveland or with other perfectly ordinary people who would never be confused with intellectuals of any kinds, or successful in any way, with the exception being Robert Crumb, it has the same feeling. And I think if the book works, that probably is the main reason that it works, also because the artists themselves have this wonderful, deep, and intuitive feeling. And one of the great case, Sharon Rudall, stopped drawing for 15 years, I think, because the market for a certain kind of feminist radical comics, looking back at history, pretty much disappeared by the middle 1980s, the phase that had come out of the underground comics world, the underground newspapers of the 60s and 70s was gone. And that spark sort of disappeared for a whole lot of artists who simply stopped drawing. But Sharon Rudall has found the subject. She did a book I edited on the life of Emma Goldman, which is utterly fabulous. And the work in here that she's done draws so deeply upon the lives of a jockey or a house worker or a baby nurse or farmers, stone cutters, and so forth, that she really touches something that even graphic novelists, who are basically fiction novelists in pictures, rarely manage to do, and she does it from the makings of people's lives. She scripted things herself, but also very much by being psychologically in tune with exactly what Studs had in mind. And I sure do hope that the book is successful enough for us to do some more Studs Terkel comics, because I think I would aspire to do that almost more than anything I can think of as a comics editor.
Can I? I just want to make this point. There's a guy who's one of my favorite writers and who influenced me and who anticipated Studs Terkel, and he's a guy from Chicago. His name is George Ade.
Sure.
He was from Indiana, from an agricultural area. He went to Purdue and then he came to Chicago in the 1890s and got a job, I think, with the Chicago Record. And at that time, the Columbia National Exhibition was, or exposition, was taking place. And they sent him out. They just sent him out in the street to just interview. He could do anything he wanted. And so he would just interview all these different kinds of people. And it was just great. I mean, he interviewed the same kind of people that Studs
right.
still.
And he did. He collaborated with the Tribune's famous, before he was at the Tribune, when they were both at the Daily News, with the famous illustrator John T. McCutcheon, mostly for Injun Summer. There is a show at the Chicago Cultural Center as we speak that's running through August of McCutcheon's work, a great deal of it. He and George Ade wrote and illustrated a column called Stories of the Streets and Sidewalks. And there are panels up there of this. There are two up there that will, I don't care how old you are, I don't care how old these things look, they're two of the finest stories. One's amazing about seeing a kid standing outside a window on the ledge of the window behind, and how Ade runs up to try to save the kid, and he's in a panic, and he goes to the mother, and he goes, "What? Your child's out there? I know. Is she out there again? Is she out there again?" She'd done it 15 times, so she was attached to a rope that was perfect. She pulls the rope, and in comes the kid. But it's a brilliant drawing too, and a great story. You got to get over and see this show, Harvey. Thanks for reminding me. And they only did this. It was so popular that I think it was a weekly. In those days, it could have been a daily. And for I think 2 or 3 or maybe 4 years. They collected them in books at the end of the year and gave them, this is what newspapers used to do, gave them to their subscribers. But I'm so glad you brought that up, because that's absolutely true.
Now
it continues in another generation, because Rick has a column
in
the paper.
Oh, I wouldn't go there. That's flattering.
And it's called Sidewalks, but it's a collaboration with a photographer,
Charles Osgood. I think what all of us are saying, and that there is no such thing, and Studs would tell you this, there is no such thing as an ordinary person. Mm-hmm. Every single person in this room is extraordinary somehow. I don't care how, I don't know how, I don't know all of you, but in conversation, if you're willing to listen, and as Paul says, not look around or through or behind people, you'll get it. And it's there every day. Harvey, I know you know this. I mean, it's your work. It's been your life's work.
Yeah, I go around looking for this stuff.
Yeah.
and yet, if you read the pages of the most prestigious review columns, by and large, and look at the novels or even the histories, they tend to be about great white men, number one, and number two, they deal very little with the lives of ordinary people of any kind whatsoever. So although in my own lifetime, the 60s gave a big push towards a different way of history. The thing about oral history is oral historians themselves were in the streets. Oral history was hardly even a profession
And mainly was the practice of places like the Harry Truman Library, where they interviewed people and then erased all the tapes so nobody would find out anything that wasn't supposed to be known. That was the vision of oral history.
Yeah.
But oral historians forming the profession, such as it is, in the 60s and 70s were mainly community activists of one kind or another, or oddballs who wanted to document a community that was disappearing under some kind of pressure or other. They made a dent, we made a dent, but not such a big dent, and we always come up against the formidable problem that the people who are in charge of society aren't all that interested in the lives of ordinary people. We're not influential enough.
Do you worry then about...
I guess I'd say that, yeah.
You've said a couple times, you've mentioned, you know, how the book doing well, or if the book does well enough. What is well enough, and what do you need this book, what kind of zeitgeist does this have to catch, you know, in order for
you... That's a really good question. As we speak, I think probably Linda Barry's panel has finished up. And if I were there, I would have asked a question I often ask, that why it is that the number of women writers and artists of comics has grown very fast, and the number of women readers as comics has followed much more slowly. That's a particular example, but there's a larger case, which is, in general, people of any kind over 50 are uncomfortable with buying books of comics. I would say until 5 years ago, any review of comics, and there weren't many, in the New York Times, New York Review, would have a last paragraph which apologized from the reviewer for having a guilty pleasure of wow. reviewing a comic book. Mm. Comics are embarrassing. They were viewed in the 1950s not only as a threat of juvenile delinquency, for which purpose there were congressional hearings, very much like the congressional hearings on communists, but also thought of as worse than television. Just as the appearance of television made movies seem not so horrible, the appearance of comic books made television not seem so horrible. Comics are worse than the bottom of the worst, and this very slow climb toward respectability, which hardly went anywhere with really no holds barred, nothing censored underground comics of the 60s and 70s, perhaps began the climb up in the U.S., very slowly in the 1990s with R. Spiegelman's Mouse, mm-hmm. and then since 2001 perhaps, a larger growing sensibility that comic art is a real form of art and can be taken seriously as a form of art. Nevertheless, there's a New York Times list of graphic books, which now appears bestsellers, which has appeared only for 2 months, first time ever. The Beats sometimes is at the bottom of that list, but the rest of the list is entirely Batman or The Watchmen. In other words, the nonfiction category of comics is pretty darn small, and too much of it is by Harvey and myself. So we're very much hoping that this kind of comic will be a gateway drug for young people to go ahead and read the books. But also that the art which is made by comic artists will be taken seriously as a form of art and understood as such and appreciated as such. And it may overcome the great difficulty, which is these books are expensive to produce because you have to pay artists. Writers don't have to be paid, as is well known, especially if they teach someplace, and generally aren't paid. Artists need to be paid, and secondly, these books don't cost so much because they can't have a heavier price than someone under 25 is going to pay. So these are serious disadvantages, but at least in terms of what critics are beginning to say, we seem to be going someplace.
I think that especially younger readers are enthusiastic for graphic novels, and they have got sort of gained a sort of cultural and critical legitimacy. This Alison Bechtel's book, Fun Home,
wonderful book.
It was a National Book Critics Circle
indeed.
Finalist.
Right, yeah.
Persepolis.
You'll run out of the list pretty soon.
I know, but at least
it's a short list.
But people are reading them. That's
right.
Just, you know.
That certainly is true. The other thing
but this book also is only $23, and I'm going to flip through. You people in the front, just take a look at this. You're getting, seriously, that seems unbelievably reasonable to me. We open this up for questions.
Please.
And they are meant to be questions, not your first comic book you ever read. You asked too many questions. You stood up there for five. I'm telling you, man, you stood up there for 5 minutes last time. Yes.
Yeah.
I'm sorry?
Okay.
To the microphone.
To the microphone. Please, to the microphone.
I appreciate you were great last time, but you can't monopolize the microphone.
Okay.
I was hoping that some or all of you would comment on the difference between the way that a book like this book portrays nonfiction versus the way that perhaps our culture is becoming obsessed with reality through reality television.
That's a wonderful question.
Because I think this is a much more honorable and respectful way.
It's not reality. I mean, they call reality television. You know, when these people go out on these ridiculous, you know, like races around the world, what does that have to do with reality? I mean, or reality. I mean, they just, you know, it's, I don't know where they get that from. I mean, you know, they show people getting mad at each other and yelling at each other all the time, and you know, it's like conflict all the time. That, you know, I mean, reality is, you know, just, you know, going home and eating supper or something like that.
Yes, or an American Splendor complaining about the Cleveland Indians.
Sir, you had made a quote that you said there's no such thing as an ordinary person. However, within the books, you highlight people's ordinary lives with, you know.
How do you define an ordinary life?
Exactly. That's kind of a segue to her question. Also, is like, if there's no such thing as an ordinary person, then what do you gauge as extraordinary or ordinary? And then on top of that, two parts. Sorry. Do either you, Harvey, or Paul feel that you're in a way romanticizing the working class as far as turning it into this is how it should be looked at instead of like Harvey, eating dinner is the reality of the job?
I think that, you know, what I'd like to do is I'm not trying to put so-called ordinary people ahead of so-called extraordinary people, but I would like to see them, you know, get raised to the same level, you know, because there are all kinds of essential jobs to do in society, and you know, very few people get credit for doing these jobs, you know, so that's, you know.
You should never mistake celebrated with extraordinary either. I mean, I don't know how good a singer Britney Spears is. She may be a great singer. But, you know, I saw Paris Hilton on David Letterman last night, and people, oh, you're extraordinary. For what? For what? And I think it's also very subjective, too, the whole view. But, don't mistake celebrate. I think too often we mistake celebrated for extraordinary, and that's unfair to all but concerned. Go ahead, Paul. What do you think?
I guess I would say if you go through the book and read carefully, and a number of the people, you could say, well, why don't they drop that job and go to another job? Why do they stay with a miserable job? And there's no easy answer to that. There are also some business executives and others that are by no means favorably treated in their own words. You know, they actually think very highly of themselves, but the reader doesn't think they do very much with their hands, coming to his or her own conclusion from it. And Studs was just taking it straight on.
Yeah.
You never have the sense of Studs talking down or engaging in false uplifting. And I'm hoping not to have done that through my editing process. And I don't think Harvey did that either. There is an inclination towards those who are underrepresented, and this comes also from my 60s social history world, to discover the lives of Latino farm workers that nobody has been willing to talk about before, or the dozens of other cases of so-called hillbillies from Appalachia who aren't thought to be articulate unless they appear as horrible murderers or drunks or whatever the usual portrait is, and to let them speak for themselves. That may be a form of romanticization. It's possible, but mostly, to hear the voices straight out, not to hear them through some other means or interpreted by us, is a victory for ordinary life and for the perception of ordinary life in a far more democratic way than most literature will allow.
Well put. More questions? Go ahead, stand up.
Well, Harvey and Paul, you guys have done three books in the last couple of years, including the SDS book. So I'm wondering, what are you working on now? So, you know,
well,
other than being at events like this.
Yiddish guy.
He wishes me to speak, yeah. Which is very curious, since I'm the editor and he's the real speaker. We've been starting work on a book called Yiddish Land. And I'm a Gentile from downstate Illinois, and I just stumbled into Yiddish through oral history. I started interviewing octogenarians, and I ended up in communities of Yiddish speakers, native Yiddish speakers, the last generation of old socialists. And they adopted me as a grandchild, and I was very eager to adopt them as grandparents, and I fell into reading Yiddish poetry and so forth. For Harvey, his first language was Yiddish. So what is the story of that 800 years that is not entirely gone, but which has an enormous richness and also had a huge impact in American popular culture that's rarely recognized? That's number one. Number two, Harvey's been writing about jazz for close to 50 years, and everybody knows how brilliant his writing is. So what we want to do after that is to do a comic about jazz in various kinds of ways. It's a fabulous idea. Now, if only somebody will offer us some money, we'll do it.
Here, I'll offer you some.
Yes, sir.
Oh, good. Hi.
Sir.
This is a precursor version. Yes, please, sir.
Thank you. I really want to honor you guys for bringing this form to something more powerful. I just want to say that I learned an awful lot from Studs Terkel, and the thing that I learned the best was how to be curious, and how to be curious in a way that left space for the person I was curious about. And, I hope that your book helps us learn better. Thank you.
Yeah. Studs was, as other panelists know him at a closer level, a fabulous personality, and you could hardly think of not looking at him when you're in the same room as him. But just the idea that you've raised, that he ceases to be the center of attention by his own determination, and that the other person has that kind of space, that's a really remarkable thing. Let me connect it with one more matter. Frequently, there are these breakthroughs in communications, and during the, not so frequently, but it's happened four or five times in the last two centuries, And most often there's a period of 10 or 20 years when all kinds of so-called amateurs come in, and like the first penny newspapers or the first radio stations before the radio was taken over by the monopolies, or the first days of live television when Studs had Studs Place on local television in Chicago, and to a degree about the web as well, and I'd throw in comics too, and we'd go through each one of these cases. And then after the beginning phase, then these areas are corporatized and the formulas are set, and then it's people who are grinding out the material that's expected of them, and they don't have much room for creativity. I discovered probably only when I began working on comics again after a long lapse that most people growing up as kids thought comics were written, drawn, and everything else by the same artist who often wasn't acknowledged. And we learn later in life it's like an assembly line. That's the way DC and Marvel comics are produced. You might ink, you might write, you might do something else, but hey, it's just the job to come in and spend your hours in and so on and so forth. We're in that phase now with art comics. That's what's exciting about it. It probably is because there is so little money in it that nobody wants to take it over. There's no indication anybody wants to take it over. But there is an enormous amount of excitement and interest, of especially of artists who are under 30. There's so much more on the web, and Harvey can talk about some of the stuff he's connected with on the web. I'm not. That is far larger in volume than anything in printed form, for obvious financial reasons. But it represents forms of expression, and especially young people finding forms of expression, creating new forms of art, which is altogether remarkable, and hopefully will point a way towards a new way of seeing the connections of art and life.
This question basically it's for Harvey and Studs, where they gave people a voice that normally didn't have a voice. And to preface this, I actually grew up in Cleveland, Ohio. And so when I read American Splendor, I don't see you giving the ordinary person a voice, but I actually see you giving in a whole entire region, you know, the city of Cleveland itself a voice. And I was wondering if you actually look at, in retrospect, in hindsight, do you look at American Splendor, do you look at your work and see it as giving a voice to this larger region, or still just the individual person?
No, maybe both. I mean, you know, like, one of my concerns is to make people feel better about themselves, to not feel bad about themselves just because maybe they don't make as much money as the other guy. But yeah, you know, Cleveland's not, it's not that bad to live in. You know, I mean, you know, you hear stuff about the Cuyahoga River catching on fire and stuff like that. But, you know, I mean, there's some nice stuff about it. And, you know, I
loved it. I grew up there, like I said.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, I think it's okay. It's decent, and people are fine. And yeah, I have concern. I am actually writing a book, graphic novel about the history of Cleveland and how, and also like my life in it. You know, talking about like, you know, great experiences I had, like when I was a little kid and I listened to the 1948 World Series, and they broadcast it, you know, they broadcast it in school over the PA system, and the Indians won. It's been a long time since Cleveland's won a championship. They just bombed out, you know, like they, you know, LeBron James or no LeBron James, they didn't make it to the finals of the NBA championship after having the best record in the league.
Ladies
but
and
I mean,
gentlemen.
I guess if you know about the Cubs, you know about Cleveland.
Thank you.
That's a great remark.
Ladies and gentlemen, Harvey, Paul, Liz, me, Studs, thanks for coming. Buy this book.
Thank you for attending today's discussion and supporting the Chicago Tribune's commitment to literacy. A book signing will take place in the Arts Room. As you exit this room to your left, it is the first room on your left.
Okay.
All right.
I think there was somebody here.
Somebody.
Ryan Duff.
Today on Washington Journal, author Richard Wolff and his new book, Renegade, The Making of a President, about the candidacy of Barack Obama, based on interviews conducted during the 2008 presidential campaign. Washington Journal starts live at 7 a.m. Eastern on C-SPAN, and we'll show it to you again at 10 p.m. Eastern here on Book TV.
The Publishing World's annual trade show is happening in New York City, and one of the publishers that is here is Chicago Review Press. Elizabeth Malzahn is the publicity director. Ms. Malzahn, tell us about some of the books that you have coming up.
We have a couple of fantastic books on the fall 2009 list. First, we have a wonderful book by Ned Sublett. He is the author of Cuba and Its Music, as well as The World That Made New Orleans. And as he was working on The World That Made New Orleans, he also began writing his memoir of writing it, and that is The Year Before the Flood. And it tells literally about as he was living in New Orleans in the French Quarter, the things that he discovered there, the people that he encountered, especially the musical history, which is really his forte. It's a beautiful book, and it'll be coming out on August 29th, which is the four-year anniversary of the Hurricane Katrina. And then we also have a book, which is a young adult narrative written by Simeon Wright, and he is the cousin of Emmett Till. He was there during the Emmett Till slaying, and this is his story as written for young adults so that they understand the historical importance for the civil rights movement and justice and peace.
And when is that coming out?
That will be coming out later on this fall, just in time for our January and February promotions for Black History Month.
What is Boomtown?
Boomtown is a really interesting case study, actually, of the ways in which Walmart changed Bentonville, Arkansas. The ways the sociological exploration, as well as the economic exploration, how immigration changes within the class society have gone through with a large corporation and how it has actually brought a lot of diversity to the company.
And finally, I want to ask you about one more book over your shoulder, Absinthe.
Absinthe and Flamethrowers. This is our best-selling author. Bill Gerstel is his name, and he writes for Make Magazine and does a lot of DIY. He's known really as MacGyver. In fact, the founder of MacGyver says if you want to know where he lives now, he lives in Minneapolis, Minnesota. This book is how to live dangerously, really. It explains a wide variety of different projects that you can actually do that are very dangerous, drinking absinthe, making your own flamethrower, but also going through and how to use a lasso, how to use a bull whip, things of that nature. He wrote Backyard Ballistics, which is a fantastic DIY book about how to build a catapult in your own backyard and things of that nature. But this also talks a lot about the philosophical reasons for why you should live on the edge and how it can bring joy and excitement to your life.
And tell us a little bit about Chicago Review Press.
Chicago Review Press was founded in the early 70s, and it is prides itself on our wonderful independent publishing program. We do a wide variety of both fiction as well as nonfiction. Our fiction is classic reissues. We have a wide variety of Anya Seton books, books that have gone out of print and that we're bringing back for the beloved fans. And then we do a wide variety of nonfiction, popular science. We have Lawrence Hill Books, which is our imprint that focuses on feminism, peace, justice, African-American interests, and Latino interests. We do kids' books. We have a fantastic for kids series that takes 25 projects, and it looks at, in particular, large historical figures, Mark Twain, Benjamin Franklin. We do a kids' guide series that looks at historical pieces, all wonderful for educators, homeschoolers, curriculum. And then we do serious nonfiction, a lot of journalism pieces that we have on anything from finance to pop culture. And then we have a lot of really fun arts and entertainment titles that we also do. We really embody the spirit of independent publishing.
Associated with the university or anything?
No, we are not associated with the university. Chicago Review Press is actually the parent company to Independent Publishers Group, which is a large distribution company that has a wide variety of publishers that we distribute here in North America. And Chicago Review Press is kind of our publishing editorial arm.
We've been talking with Elizabeth Malzahn of Chicago Review Press.
This summer, Book TV is asking, what are you reading?
Hi, I'm Bob Cusack, and the managing editor of the Hill newspaper. Hill newspaper covers politics 24/7, so in the summer I at least like to get away from politics, at least for a little bit. And one of the books I've started to read, I haven't finished yet, is called Caddy for Life. This is written by John Feinstein. He's one of the best sports writers of our time, I think. And it focuses on the life of Bruce Edwards, who was the caddy for golfing legend Tom Watson, and Edwards gets diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's disease, so it tracks his final few months on the PGA Tour. Another book that I'm going to be reading is a book written by one of my friends. It's called Receive Me Fallings by Erica Roebuck. I don't have many friends who've written books, so I'm going to be reading that this summer. It's on Amazon.com, and it's gotten some good reviews, so I'll be checking that out. Another book my wife just finished is called The Shack. It's by William Paul Young. A lot of buzz around this book. It's a fictional book. I don't know too much about it, but I hear it. You can apply this book to your everyday life, and so I'll be checking that out as well. I've always been fascinated by the search for Osama bin Laden, and I'm going to be reading a book by Michael Scheuer. He is a former CIA agent who was in charge of the unit searching for bin Laden. He recently wrote an op-ed for the Washington Post that got a lot of attention. I haven't read any of his books, but it reminded me that I should take a look at one of his books, and this one is called Marching Toward Hell, America and Islam After Iraq. The last book that I'll be checking out is called The 15th Club. I'm a big golfer, and it's kind of a how-to book. It focuses on the mental game of golf. It's written by sports psychologist Bob Rotella, and I would recommend it. I've started it. It's taken a few strokes off my game, and I can get all the help I need. So those are the books I'm going to be checking out this summer.
To see more summer reading lists and other program information, visit our website at booktv.org. The C-SPAN Civics bus is traveling the country.
The Tourette's comes on as I sat down. Because you're dealing with their own local
of our schedule. Rowan, a political
It's still